it's like this. Without tradition, you know, you have to build a tradition. I'm lucky enough to have come to a really great club, one of the greatest clubs in the world, with a tremendous tradition. So rather than be daunted by it, I admire it, I love it. Best Charlton Law. I mean, what other British team could have produced three world-class players in the one team at the one time?
The links between Northern Ireland and Manchester United are phenomenal. I mean, it borders on the unbelievable. There's a fanaticism, there's a passion among Northern Ireland people for Manchester United.
Ever since my dad gave me, you know, the first ball and my pair of football boots, the name Manchester United just was sort of like drilled into me.
The love affair is always there. I mean, everyone's dream is to play for the club. You can't play for the club, and the next best thing is you go to the games.
The greatest compliment in my life was that United and Matt Busby had bought Harry Gregg. It was the Hollywood of football.
I always knew my father worked in Belfast at Harrowing Wools, and it must have been about the early 30s. It must have been the early 30s because he played with Peter Docherty at Glentoran. I know that. I always remember him telling me stories about Peter Docherty. Of course, when I was a boy, I didn't really know Peter Docherty, if you know what I mean. And he was captain of Glentoran at the time, Peter Docherty, and he was only 18. So I'll give you an idea of the year my father played there. But when I said I didn't know about Peter Docherty, I remember going down to, went to see Derby play Liverpool in the league decider in 72, and I managed to get a ticket from Jock Steen, through Jock Steen. And I went down with his son, George, and met Shankly. And they took me in the boardroom at Derby. And there was all these photographs of the Derby players that played for their countries. And they came to Peter Docherty. And he never stopped talking about this Peter Docherty. And I says, I went like, my dad played with him. And then I said, oh, no, I better know. Might think I'm stupid. You know, I was so proud of the fact that my father had played with this great player.
Well, football in the past was the sport of the working class. It was the route for youngsters to be able to get off the streets, to find a job.
I remember playing for Mersey Street Primary School, where I lived in East Belfast, and I was about 9 years old, and this man called Bob Bishop, after one game, wanted to have a chat with me. We actually couldn't believe it, the whole family couldn't believe it, that he wanted to keep an eye on me at 9 years of age to go to Manchester. And when he said Manchester United, well, I was just starry-eyed, I couldn't believe it.
There's been Irish players at the club from the outset, but it really took off with Busby. And one of the first things he did was to appoint Bob Bishop in Belfast as his scout, and Billy Bain in Dublin, in order to uncover this untapped talent. There was no professional league here, but there was great players here who were falling by the wayside because they had nowhere to go.
I used to play for St Oliver Plunkett, which is a team in West Belfast. And through there and the school I went to when I was younger, La Salle Boys, I was spotted and asked me to come over for a trial. And like, I was over the moon, you know what I mean, playing for a trial for Man United at such an early age.
I came over 16-year-old. It was in Diggs. And Busby's was getting all these young boys from all parts of British Isles, even more so than the team of today.
The first time I went across, you know, it was brilliant, you know, Manchester United, biggest club in Europe, all this, you know. It's more reputation the club's got. So when I went over, you know, it was just brilliant to be there. Brilliant to be one of the players.
Don't get involved with anything silly with referees or the opposition tonight. David on the back post, two centre backs up.
Some of tonight's young players have already been in our senior international squad, and obviously some of the rest of them, they're looking to make their way now at their clubs in England and hopefully get a professional contract by the end of this season.
I was first really noticed what when David was 9, 10, so he was when the Manchester United scout noticed David. And just kept an eye on him through that first couple of years, you know, and then we got him up to Lisburn Youth and Manchester United sort of took over from them.
Comes to the age when you're 16, you sign YTS, and they offered me a 2-year YTS, and I wasn't going to turn it down, you know, just work hard and, you know, hopefully get a pro contract.
I would say that youngsters from the province want to join Manchester United first and foremost. Most of them want to be professional footballers, but if they get the opportunity of joining a club with the background of Manchester United, then that's it. They see this, I think, as a sort of Roy of the Rovers dream, you know, the realisation of childhood fantasies.
This is McCready, and McCready's made a catch, and it's a magnificent goal!
I think how I felt signing for Manchester United was a dream come true, in that I was something I thought about, something I dreamt about, something I thought would never happen, yet wanted to happen, was actually happening. And again, at 15, sensing that this was happening to me, I felt tremendously privileged that here I was, I think, and still think, the biggest club in the world.
Formed in 1878 by the carriage workers at the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railway, and formed as Newton Heath, and went under the Football Alliance a couple of years later. They were very much a pub team in those days. They actually changed at the Three Crowns Inn in Oldham Road and walked to their first pitch. They worked during the day, played football on a Saturday morning, changed in the pub. And very much working class. Big Irish population has us that northwest part of England. It's still Irish to this day. They always say the ambitious people went to Manchester, and the ones weren't so ambitious stayed in Liverpool.
I think you have to be realistic in whatever walk of life that you decide is your profession, and everyone can't be a doctor, everyone can't be a solicitor, everyone can't play for Man United.
Right, well, we're in the spare room of my home here where I carry out the duties of the secretary of the carried off Manchester United Supporters Club. as you can see, have filled the room full of a lot of Manchester United memorabilia. I think it's nice to actually sit in and look around and take it all in. I mean, I'm quite proud of the way I have the little room. Over the last 8 months, I'd actually compiled a Manchester United quiz book, and I couldn't believe it when I got a letter back from Manchester United's official publishers. This is a hard copy of it, who have actually agreed to publish it for me. I was hoping to call it Alex Ferguson's Manchester United quiz book, but Alex has kindly declined and just said, it's your quiz book, John, you call it John White's Manchester United quiz book. But the boss himself has decided to write the foreword to the book for me. So it'll be published early next year. I'm quite proud of that fact, and I don't know what venture might start next.
There has been quite a lineage of Irish players with United beginning pre-war. But of course, to me, the real Irish connection began with Jackie Carey. Many people will call him Johnny, but I always knew him as Jackie, and indeed as did his family.
Manchester kickoff. Renowned slow starters, their match-winning attack seems to have lost the rhythm that has brought them along the road to Wembley. A close duel between Manchester's Johnny Carey and Blackpool's Walter Rickett, number 11, is highlight number one in a thrill-packed match.
Jackie Carey was an absolute superstar who played for both Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. Indeed, for Northern Ireland on a Saturday, the Republic on a Sunday, something which wouldn't happen now. But he was the person that the Irish focused to at Manchester United.
The King hands the silver trophy to skipper Johnny Carey. Their 4-2 victory, snatched in the last few minutes, gives Manchester United the reward they richly deserve.
He was Matt Busby's right-hand man, his eyes and ears on the pitch, and he was the man earmarked by Busby to lead his first team. Busby built three teams, and Carey led the first one. And in 1948, he became the first Irishman to lift the FA Cup.
The first question, Matt, is how do you find these boys?
Well, actually, Bill, I have a scouting system whose sole object is to go out looking for young, promising school boys, youth club boys, and indeed any young players who have the necessary natural ability to make a future Manchester United player.
Carey was the one at that time, and then there was a sort of a blank for a period until you come up to the Busby Babes, and that is really when the Northern Ireland link became very strong, thanks to, first of all, Bob Harper, who was a scout, and then the legendary Bob Bishop.
Manchester United, they've had this huge policy going for ages. And Manchester United is number one here in most boys' eyes, definitely. Every boy you talk to would like to get there.
I wanted to go that quickly that I had no feelings. That when something like this is offered to you, you're attracted by the importance of it all.
Jackie played for the Scotland international team with me in 47, 48, and United took him, and nobody bothered with me.
Oh, you were in awe, because the players that we heard on the radio, you were training with them, and you were in a different world altogether. Different world. The only ambition was to be as good as they were.
Here's Berry, getting them going. Berry, number 7 with the ball. Still United on the attack.
Another number 10, Edwards. Equalising goal must come. And there it is! Yes, it's a great goal! It's scored!
Berry going through with it by himself. Cross it comes and Tom's made a perfect hit.
It was a tremendously happy time. There were boys that had come to this club from leaving school. And you get a tremendous kick out of a boy coming and eventually coming through and making himself a top-class player. And in this era of the supposed Busby Babes, we had quite a lot come through, actually practically a team. And of course, you get a tremendous sense of seeing a boy achieving this, and you get a tremendous sense of achievement yourself.
Out of the blue, Sheffield Wednesday came in and offered something like £15,000 for this fellow Gregg, and I began to wonder, can I play? And a short time later, the then great Manchester United offered a world record fee. And that was my beginning at United. I joined what I considered to be, at that point in time, I joined the greatest pool of players in the history of English football.
Well, it was like heaven on earth, you know. This was all I ever dreamt about, all I ever thought about. And, you know, while my mum and dad say you've got to go on with your education meant nothing to me. It was getting to Old Trafford and just being there, because at that particular time, the likes of George Best had reached his zenith, and watching him and just cleaning his boots would have been tremendous.
I always wanted to play for Manchester United, even at that young age, but when I left home, when I left my mum and dad, first time I went over, I came over on a boat, and it was a dreadful experience. I was in Manchester again, I wanted to come home. To be totally honest with you, I was frightened to death.
You make a decision immediately, it's only afterwards that you think, have I made the right decision? And for a particular spell there of about maybe 2 or 3 months after I arrived in Manchester, I did get a lot homesick.
First few months, you know, you're over on your own, only phone calls, no parents. You have to take it easy in everything that you do, your money-wise, washing. Everything that you do, you have to look after yourself.
Goodness me, we nearly broke our heart when I was going away. The morning he was going away, over to Manchester to live, we were going on holidays to Butlins the same morning. And we could hardly go. We cried, going in the car, on the boat. But you get over it.
I'd never been out of Belfast. This was my first experience. This was new, and this could be for a long time. And I was beginning to feel the seeds of homesicknesses, wanting to get home again. And I think that affected me.
As the months went on, you know, you get used to it. The matches are starting. Pre-season's the hardest bit. You know, get that out of the way, get the training done, and start playing matches, and then the season flies through.
I used to go over on my own to Old Trafford, but sometimes going on your own got quite lonely. After that, it progressed and they actually joined a supporters club in Belfast. I got married, we had a little boy, Mark, and then stayed away from the supporters club for a while.
Yeah. Then obviously I'd have to fill the guys in for Thursday for the Casiche game, and then this weekend's match against Blackburn.
And then, as I said it one day, I just said to my wife, listen, I need to go back over. You know, it was always in my blood. Even when I wasn't going to Old Trafford, it'd be the first result to look for. I'd lift the paper, I'd be listening to them on the radio, watching them on the TV. And then they said it right, you know, I'm living in Carriduff. There's no supporters club in Carriduff. I'm sure there's a great fan base in Carriduff. And I'd have said it, I'll place an advertisement in the local paper.
But we're on talking through the Solskjaer presentation. Yeah. And Aston Villa. In case any of the boys want to go to that on the 15th of December.
Is that going much?
Well, there's about 30 names down for it. And then obviously there's Everton on Boxing Day, but I don't know if we'll have a lot of guys going there over Christmas.
I called a meeting at the Maysfield Leisure Centre and had no idea if 2 or 102 people were going to turn up. And to be honest, I was quite surprised of the response. I had to stand in front of a room full of people which I never met before in my life. I basically set out my aims. They all wanted the same aims. I told them we were going to call a carried off branch.
When I go to Ireland, north or south, I mean, it's just incredible that this love and passion for the team, for the club. And I don't know how many members we've got now in Northern Ireland, but it must be well into 80,000 supporters and who regularly travel over, and it catches your breath really, and it can be quite, it's an all-consuming thing, you know, that can overtake you at times in the passion of the show.
Players are losing this ball in the sun, but it was best who picked up that kid flick.
People are link themselves with the George Best era, with Eric Cantona, but Manchester United is a club which just is part of the family life in many households in Northern Ireland.
McIlroy is through, and McIlroy has done it! What's drama here?
It was my father, really. He was the one that was pushing me. I mean, it was a time the trouble started in Belfast in 69 as well, and it was a little bit, it was a bad time back home. My mother would have kept me home, there's no doubt about that. But my dad was saying, there's nothing here for you, son, you know, get over there and have a real go. But, you know, he was the one that really said, give it your apprenticeship, give it the 2 years and see what happens.
The background I came from was a very small background. The world was a big place, but I wasn't aware of the largeness of that big place. And so to take such a young lad, an only child, out of that environment and put him in the midst of Old Trafford, while being very glamorous, I don't think I had the emotional or the mental equipment to carry that and to cope with that.
I would say for the first year, it was the hardest. The first year was definitely the hardest. I was coming home maybe every 2 weekends. Phoning home regularly, just like being homesick, just thinking I was missing out on things, so, because it's just like the first time I'd ever been away from home for such a long time. But everybody at the club just makes you feel so welcome. Like, at the first I was overawed, but the managers settled me down and like everything just took on from there.
My philosophy and my beliefs and all that are quite straightforward and simple. And I expect all my staff to be falling in line behind me in that respect. So if any young boy is getting carried away at any of the levels in their, from youth right through to the first team, I expect my people to deal with it very, very firmly. And if they're finding difficulty, then they'll come to me, and if I get involved, then it could be quite a to-do, you know? Because the last thing we want in here is young people to go back to their mothers differently from when they came.
We were wanting David to finish his schooling, you know, which was very important to him at the time. And then with Manchester United, they explained everything, that school could be carried on in Manchester at the local, you know, college over there. And we accepted that. But it was an experience that, you know, a lot of parents, you know, like ourselves, would find very hard to let their son go away from home at 16 years old. It would hit David very hard if it didn't work out for him at Manchester United and wasn't offered a pro contract.
Jimmy Murphy was the assistant manager then, and he talked to my dad and talked to me, and they said, listen, if you come home and you feel you want to come back, perhaps you could come back to us. But suppose I have no big regrets. I thought it was a great experience, because in coming home, my life changed. And some people who are not interested in football may think that football is just an interest, it's just a hobby. I suppose when I went back a few years ago to watch the match between Man United and Aston Villa, I became more philosophical because I looked round at this massive crowd. All kinds of classes, upper class, middle class, working class people. And I could see that they had a consuming passion with football. And I can see why others can say that football becomes their god, it becomes their religion, and they sing off the same song sheet, they worship a team. And I could see that, perhaps for the first time, just a few years ago. This was big in the minds of people. It was not only their passion, it had become their god.
My intention to begin with was to reflect the views of the fans, and when you've got a large group of people who are looking at personalities in a similar way, You want to make it into an image, you know, reflect it. I had a number of ideas about producing an image of Eric as a Renaissance kind of character. But I wanted to choose a painting that, or a number of paintings that could reflect United's achievements and Eric Cantona's achievements as an icon. We've got in the foreground a composition from the Resurrection of Christ by Piero della Francesca, and the background, Mantegna.
Well, here we are in the children's playroom, which is fast becoming another shrine to Manchester United. Over there, I've got some. Last game, the West Ham match.
There are those that are blessed with greatness and they're not fit to carry it. There are those that are blessed with greatness and humility. And he was a great man, Matt Busby, because he had the humility to carry greatness. He was a great man.
He was someone who really took a grip of football, had players respecting him, players looking up to him, and he had a very, very good basic knowledge of what football was all about, and he had that ability as well to make players believe that they were even better than they are.
Many, many times when they tried something that didn't come off, I was that's the right thing to do. That's the right thing to do. And with it all, I was always very happy that they were a creative side, building up creation rather than destruction.
Morgan, he's got Best and McIlroy! Sammy McIlroy, the scorer. Taken by Charlton. Still loose, McIlroy! McIlroy, the scorer.
That was the last signing Sammy McIlroy made as a professional, and I was so proud because he was absolutely magnificent man. He knew everyone at the club. The land, the cleaners, the kit ladies, everything, and he called them all by their first name. The apprentices, all the players at the club, he made them feel wanted. And he had a sort of like a training method where the young boys would train with the first team as well. And, you know, for like us apprentices at 15, the actual train with Dennis Law, Best, Charlton, it was tremendous. And that was his way of getting you in, getting at a family club.
The club has progressed from maybe 60 people to 300 members, and whereas in 1981 we had 6 trips throughout the season, last year we organised 15 coach trips over to Old Trafford, and the branch itself organised 22 trips in total last season, home and away.
Hey, somewhere about that, how they get that?
Mark, tennis reps. This week's correspondence that's come in was a fax from Mr. Alex Ferguson. I'll just read it out to you briefly. It is a pleasure to write a few words at the start of John White's Manchester United quiz book. He has spent over a year researching the questions and answers, in brackets, and I am delighted that his labours have now been rewarded in print. John has
Alex Ferguson has built a team at Manchester United comprising mainly of youth, and that team is winning practically all trophies made available to them.
Manager at Manchester United FC.
We're basically back to the Busby area.
Whelan coming back to challenge him, and Blanchflower beating him. And Lynn moving up in the attack. Now here's Blanchflower
we developed through the A team and the reserve team. And eventually, we used to get an odd game or two singly, but then one particular night in 53, he made about eight changes and put eight young lads in. It went on from there. And we got the reputation of the Busby Babes. Sadly, didn't last long.
We'd started a youth system and from the start, and it was there, and you could see players of caliber there, but they were still very young. And it got to the stage I started thinking to myself, will I do it, will I not? And we played this match, and I've put a lot of these young boys in, and we won 4-0. And I remember the following day, walking along the golf course, and these things were turning over my mind, and I said to myself, well, they've won 4-0, but what was the strength of the 4-0 win? And this went on for a couple of days. Will I put them in, will I not? Mm. And all of a sudden I said, right, I'm going to put them all in.
Back in 55 or 56, I think it was, he took Manchester United into the European Cup when everyone was against it. But he had a vision of the club, he had a vision of European football, which was beyond everyone else in the game.
This was not a Scottish game, it was not an English game, it was not a Irish game, it was a world game. Mm. And in view of that, I influenced them to join the European Association, the European Company, with a view to playing the European Cup.
Manchester, 4 goals down in the aggregate, need a miracle to save them. Is this it? Peg centres. Taylor does the rest.
In 1956, our boys, it was the very young side, we played Real Madrid, who were probably one of the greatest club sides, if not the greatest it's ever been. And we lost, I thought, through inexperience because we were a very young team.
This was our second adventure. We had played Red Star Belgrade at Old Trafford 2 or 3 weeks before. We were in front, I think, by a solitary goal. I mean, out there in the quarterfinals, if we were through, we were into the semi-final. If I were to tell you a team talk, when the boss would be talking, he would never call the opposition, but he would always make you feel you were better than they were. He would talk about, if you weren't good enough, you wouldn't be here. Now out you go and you play and you do this and that. And Jimmy Murphy wouldn't be speaking, but his lips would be moving. And the boss would leave the room. Boss very calm. Jimmy very vibrant, Welsh-Irish mixture. And when he left the room, Jimmy would say, I was there during the war. They shot your fathers and mothers. He'd have you going out fired up like an animal. We played the game, it was a fair bit of hassle, it was one hell of a game, but we were through. We were through in aggregate. And I can assure you, a very happy party. Got up the following morning, nothing untoward at all, set off for the airport.
We stopped at Munich on the way back to take fuel so as we could get home.
Snowing slightly, everybody was happy as a sandboy. Into the terminal, bought a few presents, everybody bought for somebody.
And we were only there about an hour or so. And we tried two times to take off.
Belted myself in and set off down the runway, and the snow had a little bit deeper without being frightening. And I just sat looking out the window. And then all of a sudden I watched the wheels lock and unlock, and the plane started to slew about the runway, locked and unlocked, and he got her stopped. And she was slightly side on. But as that was happening, I was 2 seats from the galley. And there were no doors in the galley, it was like beads, strings. And the steward came flying out of the galley halfway through this procedure, ashen-faced, and threw himself in an empty seat beside a lady and child and strapped himself in. I thought the fellow was very, very frightened. They got the thing stopped, and they come on, somebody come on, said technical hitch. They would go back to the beginning and do it, they would do it again. Anyway, off we go again, and I watched with more interest this time. And all I know is that we went places we hadn't been before. We went further than we had been the first time, but almost the same thing happened, identical. She started to spin.
It got us off the plane and we thought we're here for the evening. But a few minutes later, they said, get back on the plane again, we're going to have a third attempt.
And the plane started to roll, went out onto the runway. And this time I did pay attention. And I watched the bow wave of snow get bigger, and I watched where we were going, and we were going, and she extended the full way. And we had been places we had never been before, and I thought, we're definitely up this time, because the telescopic leg that carries the waves had lifted the whole lot off. And all of a sudden, as I saw them lift, there was just a tremendous... Oh, you can't describe it, I'm not going to try to.
I can remember practically everything about it. I kept going in and out of consciousness, but I remember being shot through the roof. And, I broke the seat belt. That was the force was that great. I broke the seat belt.
1 minute it's darkness, and then there's splinters of daylight, and I felt the top of my head coming off, and something going up my nose. And the thing I couldn't relate is, it was 3 o'clock in the afternoon basically, and I couldn't relate darkness to light. You know what's going on. And as the whole thing broke up, I can swear on my life now, I thought, I've done well in my life. I won't see my wife, my little girl again. I won't see my family.